Hey folks, welcome to Digimento Education. This is Electronic Devices and Circuits, Lecture 19. Hopefully you are all doing great and continuously revising the concepts that I covered in the past 18 lectures. I am a course instructor, Utkarsh Upadhyay. Let's begin this lecture. Hit the like button if you really like the video, share and subscribe to our channel and write down your comments below in the comment section. So in the last lecture, we basically discussed about three type of diodes like light emitting diode, varector diode, point contact diode, okay, and tunnel diode. In this lecture, we are going to discuss about three most important diodes like Zener diode, Schottky diode, and solar cells. Okay, let's begin our discussion with the Zener diodes. The Zener diode is basically a breakdown diode. It's quite familiar. It must be quite familiar to you. It is used as a voltage regulator circuit in order to basically construct a constant DC output for the fluctuating input DC. The symbol of the Zener diode is like this. It's a Z, A, and K. This is anode and cathode. IV characteristics of the Zener diode is like this. You can see when it is forward biased, it has a cut-in voltage of 0.7 because Zener diodes are always made up of silicon semiconductor. Okay, so when forward biased, the Zener diode basically acts as a normal diode with a cut-in voltage of 0.7 and follow the normal diode characteristics. Okay, when it is reverse biased, and if the reverse bias voltage is less than the breakdown voltage in magnitude, it works as a normal diode, which means that it acts as an open circuit. But when the voltage is equal to or greater than the breakdown voltage, then it basically acts as a constant voltage source. The voltage source basically circles around the breakdown voltage. Breakdown voltage, which is basically defined for every Zener diode. Okay, it has a constant voltage source and the current increases substantially from IZ knee to IZ maximum. Let me explain these concepts line by line, which I have written here. You can see a p-junction diode with a little higher doping levels is just to correct major correction doping levels, so it's 10 to power 5, wherein breakdown act as a constant voltage source. That's why I already just mentioned. So for operation, it should be operated in breakdown region, otherwise it will work as a normal diode, which so there is no need of Zener diode. Fabricated only with silicon, just keep in mind that it is only fabricated with silicon. Is always operated in reverse biasing. When forward biasing, that is a normal diode with cut-in voltage of 0.7. Okay. Other applications basically include, it is used as a switch, faster in operation than a normal diode, as a normal diode, as a clipper or limiter or signal chopper, which you will study in analog circuits, used as a voltage reference. Okay. Acts as a rectifier, used to convert the given sine wave into a square pulse. It is specified in terms of breakdown voltage and maximum power dissipation or the minimum power rating. Just keep in mind that minimum power, these two terms, minimum power rating and maximum power dissipation, are used interchangeably. So whenever you encounter any question stating minimum power rating or maximum power dissipation, you have to consider them to be the same. Okay. Commercial Zener diodes come with breakdown voltages in the range of 2.5 volt to 300 volt. Zener diode with abrupt p-n junction when operated in reverse bias exhibits tunneling effect. Of course, if the Zener diode the tunneling effect only occurs when the junction is abrupt, as we studied about a tunnel diode in the last lecture, where the doping concentrations are quite high, so that the depletion region is very very small. And the electrons can easily transfer, it can easily cross the junction at the velocity of light. Okay, that's why that is what referred to as a tunneling effect. When operated in breakdown, the current across the Zener diode suddenly increases from minimum or the knee current to maximum allowed current, which is all due to the breakdown phenomena. When reverse bias voltage is greater than the breakdown voltage in magnitude, more current passes through it, but voltage drop is maintained constant across it, hence is also called as constant voltage device. So there's some parameters of the Zener diode. We should also study about, there is a, if we just talk of the non-ideal diode, it has basically the internal resistance, which is referred to as RZ, which is Zener resistance, which is delta V by delta IZ. So for ideal Zener diode, RZ is equal to 0, otherwise RZ should be as small as possible for better operation. Power dissipation is defined as PZ is equal to IZ into VZ. If we just talk of PZ maximum, maximum power dissipation or minimum power rating of the Zener diode is VZ into IZ maximum for ideal, and PZ it will be equal to VZ into IZ max plus IZ max square plus into RZ. This is for non-ideal diode. Equivalent circuit representation, when the diode is operated in forward biasing, it is represented as normal cut-in voltage or a series combination of forward resistance and V gamma. When reverse bias and it is in breakdown region, you can see Zener diode is in reverse bias and breakdown region. This acts as a constant voltage source, VZ. This is for the ideal Zener diode. And if it is a practical Zener diode, it will have some resistance, which is RZ. Okay. So RZ, you can see this is the plot of a practical Zener diode. So you can see there is this, it is delta VZ and this is delta IZ. There is a small change in VZ. Zener voltage results into a small change in the current IZ, large change in current IZ basically. So we can say that RZ should be as small as possible because change in current is higher as compared to the change in voltage. That's why your Zener resistance will be quite slow, quite small. Zener breakdown phenomena, there are two types of phenomena that basically cause breakdown to occur. First one is the Zener breakdown phenomena, which is due to the large electric field existing in the depletion region. Large number of covalent bonds break or rupture. As a result, current suddenly increases and attains a value of IZ minimum. This is a Zener breakdown phenomena. This only exists for breakdown voltages less than 6 volt. Okay, we know that breakdown voltage is inversely proportional to the square root of doping concentration. So for the Zener breakdown phenomena to occur, doping levels should be as high as possible so that the breakdown voltages are very, very small, which is less than 6 volts. Then only the breakdown phenomena occurs. Zener breakdown voltage decreases with the temperature. That's why it has NTC, negative temperature coefficient. Zener breakdown is basically sharp as compared to avalanche breakdown phenomena. As you can see that W, since doping concentration is quite high, W will be small and electric field is inversely proportional to W. As your W decreases, electric field intensity increases. So large E basically exists. So you can see this is basically the plot IV characteristics of a Zener diode with Zener breakdown phenomena. Okay. What about the avalanche breakdown phenomena? It occurs at very high voltages. It occurs for low doping levels. So it basically occurs due to the electron multiplication. Electron multiplication is a result of impact ionization. What is impact ionization? When highly energized electrons, when collide with immobile ions in the junction, in the depletion region, leads to rupturing of multiple covalent bonds, creating electron hole pairs. And the resulting and the so formed electrons also have very high kinetic energy. Again, they collide with more immobile ions, resulting into multiple electron hole pairs, and this process multiplies. So due to the impact ionization occurs for voltages greater than 6 volt in magnitude. Okay, avalanche breakdown voltage increases with temperature. It has a PTC, positive temperature coefficient. Avalanche breakdown is not sharp. VBR is inversely proportional to the square root of doping concentration. So in lightly doped diode, breakdown is due to the avalanche effect, and in highly doped diode, breakdown occurs due to the Zener effect. This is important. Examiner can basically frame any theoretical question from this particular concept. So it is important to keep this concept in mind. Okay. For example, you can see this is avalanche effect taking place. The electron, which are the mighty charge carriers, are repelled towards the junction. When they cross the junction, they collide with the immobile ions, creating one neutral atom and electron hole pairs. Electrons, the resulting electrons also possess high kinetic energy. They are highly energized. They again collide with more immobile ions, creating more neutral atoms and electron hole pairs. And this process continues. this results into a sudden increase in the current across the Zener diode. Okay, this occurs for the higher voltages. So you can see this is IV characteristics of a Zener diode when avalanche breakdown occurs. Okay, understood. Let's move on to another type of diode. Now let's have a look at the solar cells. The solar cell is basically basically solar cell was incorporated in the gate syllabus from 2016 gate. So a solar cell is important for gate as well as IES and other PSU or PSU examinations. So it's important that you know the concept behind the solar cell and the formulas which are basically used in solar cells for finding out the current or the open circuit voltage or the terminal voltages. Okay, let's have a look at the solar cell. It is important for gate as well as IES, because the solar cell was recently was included in the gate 2016 syllabus. So it's there in this in the gate syllabus. So you can expect question to be asked from this particular topic. Now it's basically a photovoltaic cell. Principle behind the working of a solar cell is photovoltaic effect, which is basically the conversion of light energy into terminal voltage. Okay, it's basically a PN junction diode with no external voltage connected or applied across the junction, and a load is connected across the junction. You can see there is a load which is connected across the junction of a PN junction diode. When the light falls on the PN junction, you can see the light is falling on this PN junction. Due to the photonic energy, covalent bonds break, resulting in electron hole pairs, and because of the built-in electric field intensity, this is a built-in electric field intensity which is present due to the energy barrier, or this is which is present due to the presence of immobile ions on either side of the junction. Electrons flow towards N region and holes flow towards P region, resulting in a photocurrent. The photocurrent basically flows in the direction of the holes and opposite to the direction of electrons. Okay, photocurrent generates a voltage drop across the load, which indicates the solar cell has supplied power to the load. Okay, so you can see the after the creation of electron hole pairs, the holes drift towards the P region and electrons drift towards the N region because of the built-in electric field intensity. And a photocurrent flows, which you can the direction of which you can see easily in the diagram. Okay, so there is a potential drop across the load, which we can calculate using the DC voltmeter, which we can measure using the DC voltmeter. This is plus minus VO. This is a terminal voltage. Okay, so it's quite tacit that photocurrent is a drift current, because the current which is flowing is due to the drifting of the charge carriers. This solar cells are fabricated with silicon or gallium arsenide or with third or fifth group compound semiconductor. Terminal voltages is very small, which lies in the range of 0.1 volt to 0.5 volt. Typical value being 0.56. So typical value is basically 0.56 volt and the maximum voltage being 0.5 volt. Terminal voltage can be measured using a DC voltmeter. It is widely used in satellites, which act as their power source. And during eclipse, nickel cadmium battery supplies power to it. Eclipse means when satellites come behind. When the satellite comes behind the Earth and it is not exposed to the sunlight, so the solar cells cannot generate power at that time. That's why your nickel cadmium battery is used to supply the power to it. It acts as a renewable source of energy. Nowadays, you can see that many households and many industries basically use solar cells to generate power, which is also a green source of energy. Okay, it is also known as a green energy because it does not pollute the environment in any way, because we are just using the resources which are readily available to us from the nature, and using that for generating the energy. And this doesn't even pollute the environment, so it is environment friendly as well. Okay, so there are some terms which basically are used to denote, used to describe. The voltage source used to describe the functioning of the solar cell. So first, we define an open circuit voltage, which is basically the terminal voltage of the solar cell, is basically equal to VT ln 1 plus IL by IS. Okay, this comes, so this is VOC is open circuit, VT is a thermal voltage, ln 1 plus IL. IL is the photon current, or you can say the forward current. IL is the load current. Okay, or you can also write it as VOC is equal to VT ln 1 plus JL by JS. JL and JS are current densities. So IL or JL are current forward current or current density, while your IS or JS are reverse saturation current or current density. Okay, IS is a reverse saturation current. Your IS is basically defined as AQDP PN0 upon LP plus AQDN NP0 upon LN. So this is the same expression which we wrote in the couple of lectures before. So when we basically wrote the forward current equation, which is equal to IF is equal to IS e to the power VD by eta VT. So we described IS as a reverse saturation current, and this is also that reverse saturation current is equal to this particular expression. So it's all the same. The expression will remain the same. So your JS will be equal to IS divided by area. This becomes QDP PN0 upon LP plus QDN NP0 upon LN. I think you are all familiar with the terms which are used here, like DP, which is diffusion constant. LP is basically the whole carrier life diffusion length, and its LN is electron diffusion length, and DN is basically the diffusion constant of electron. Okay, there's one more term that we define. Let me use different color to denote describe that. Okay, let me use red color to describe that. We define a term called fill factor. That's important term. It's a fill factor of a solar cell. Fill factor is defined as maximum obtained power. Maximum obtained power, which is defined as Pmax, maximum obtained power from the light, divided by VOC into ISC. VOC is basically the open circuit or the terminal voltage. ISC is short circuit current or the photocurrent. Okay, and we define the efficiency eta of a solar cell, which is defined as maximum obtained power, maximum obtained power Pmax upon G into A. Okay, G is basically your input power density, which is basically input light or power density, which is defined as watts per meter square. And A is defined as the area of cross section. We can say it's a surface area, which is defined in meter square. Okay, so these are two more terms which come into picture and are very, very important, because the question has already been asked in GATE 2016. Let me solve that example so that the concept becomes more clearer to you to understand. Okay, let's have a look at this example. Okay, let's have a look at this question. The figure shows IV characteristics of a solar cell illuminated uniformly by a solar light of power 100 watt per centimeter square. The solar cell has an area of 3 centimeter square and fill factor of 0.7. Okay, find the maximum efficiency in percentage of the device. This question basically appeared in EC GATE 2016. This is the IV characteristic which is given to us. Okay, where ISC is 180 milliampere and VOC is 0.5 volt. Okay, so we now know that the fill factor is 0.7. So from here we can conclude that fill factor is basically defined as maximum power received from the light divided by VOC into ISC. 0.7 will be equal to P maximum divided by VOC is 0.5 into ISC is 180 into 10 to the power minus 3. Okay, so from here we can get P max as 0.063 watt. Okay, now we know efficiency is equal to P max upon G into A, area. Okay, so P max is 0.063 divided by G. So we know the power density is 100 watt per centimeter square. Be careful with the units. 3 centimeter square into 3. So if you solve this, you get 0.21, which is 21%. So answer for this is 21%. Okay. Let's have a look at one more question. Now let's draw our attention to this example. Consider a PN junction at T is equal to 300 Kelvin, which with the following parameters: Na, we are given the doping concentrations, 5 into 10 to the power 18 per centimeter cube, Nd is 10 to the power 16 per centimeter cube, Dn is 25 centimeter square per second, Dp is 10 centimeter square per second, tau n0 is 5 into 10 to the power minus 7 second, and tau p0 10 to the power minus 7 second. If the photocurrent density is 10 milliampere per centimeter square, then find the open circuit voltage of the solar cell when the solar intensity is increased by a factor of 10. Assume Vt is 26 millivolt, Ni is this, and temperature is maintained constant. Just remember that when the solar intensity is increased by any factor, there is a proportional increase in the decrease in the current which flows through the circuit. So in this case, if the solar intensity is increased by a factor of 10, then we can say that the photocurrent also increases by a factor of 10. So there is a proportional proportional relationship between the intensity and the current which flows in the circuit. So first of all, with the available information, we can find out the value of Js, which is the current density. We know this is a reverse saturation current density. We can easily find Q dp ni square upon Lp Nd plus Q Dn Ni square upon Ln into Na. If you plug the value, if you basically replace Lp with square root of Dn into, so in this case square root of Dn into tau n, and make some modifications, you get the final expression as Q into Ni square upon Nd square root of dp upon tau p0 plus q ni square upon na square root of dn upon tau n0. Okay, now if you plug in the values, you get 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19. If you take q ni square out as a common, if you take q ni square term as out of this expression as a common term, so we get into 1.5 into 10 power to the power 10 whole square, 1 by 10 to the power 16 into 10 to the power 4 plus 1 upon 5 into 10 to the power 18 into 7.07 into 10 to the power 3. If you solve for this Js, you get it as 3.6 into 10 to the power minus 11 ampere per centimeter square. So from here we have got Js as 3.6 into 10 to the power minus 10 ampere per centimeter square. Since we are maintaining the temperature constant, so there will not be any change in the reverse saturation current, but as we know that reverse saturation current is dependent on temperature, it just doubles for every 10 degree rise in temperature. Since we are not changing the temperature, it will remain constant for the second case as well. Okay. Now, since intensity of light is increased by a factor of 10, so your new current, which is basically your JL, So from we can say that JL dash will be equal to JL into 10. So we are given that there is a photocurrent density of 10 milliampere per centimeter square. So it will be equal to 10 into 10 into 10 to the power minus 3 ampere per centimeter square, which is 100 milliampere per centimeter square. Now we need to find out the VOC. VOC will be equal to VT ln 1 plus JL prime upon JS. Okay, this is given to us as 26 milli ln 1 plus JS prime is 100 milli divided by 3.6 into 10 to the power minus 11 ampere per centimeter square, which is this. If you solve for this, you get it as, you get VOC as 0.565 volt. So this will be your answer. Okay, this basically ends our discussion on solar cells. Now let's draw our attention to the last type of diode, which is known as a Schottky diode. Okay, now let's have a look at another type of diode that we are going to discuss. Okay, the symbol of a Schottky diode is this, which is basically in front of you. The symbol basically there is a basically minute difference between the symbols of Schottky diode and a Zener diode. In the Zener diode, this portion is like this segment is like Z, is like Z. But in this Schottky diode, the symbol this segment is like S. You can basically use that trick to basically establish the difference between the symbols of Schottky diode and Zener diode. Okay, it is also called as metal semiconductor junction diode. It exhibits the rectification properties. It is formed when a metal such as aluminium is brought into contact with a moderately doped n-type semiconductor to form a rectified junction. Okay, in Schottky diode, the total depletion width is present in the semiconductor, that is on n side. Because your metal is heavily doped, so you can see the electron concentration is very high. So it's basically a degenerate, you can say it's a basically a degenerate semiconductor. By the way, it's not a semiconductor. I am using the terminologies in terms of semiconductor to basically describe the metal. Metal has a large pool of electrons, that's why the depletion width is negligible in the metal. So the maximum depletion, so whatever depletion width is present is present in the n-type semiconductor. Okay, so total depletion width is present in the n-type semiconductor. Total width of depletion region, it is given by this particular formula, where Vj is basically mod Vo plus Vrb, or it can be when operated in reverse biasing, or when operated in forward biasing, Vj will be equal to Vo minus mod Vd. The IV characteristics of this diode is similar to that of a normal diode, as forward current equation is same for both the diodes. Okay, the current in the Schottky diode is due to the flow of majority charge carriers. So Schottky current is due to the electrons. It is a unipolar device because electrons in the case of n-type semiconductor and holes in the case of p-type semiconductor play dominance over other are majorly responsible for the current flow. That's why your Schottky diode, which basically has a large pool of electrons, is considered to be a unipolar device, because the concentration of electrons is very high as compared to the hole concentration. Since there is no minority charge carriers, the minority carrier storage lifetime is zero. Hence, the switching time from forward bias to reverse bias is very small. So you can say it occurs pronto, it occurs quickly. Okay, so the switching time of a Schottky diode is very small, that's why it is faster as compared to the normal diode. Cut-in voltage is 0.3 volt. Schottky diode is much faster than the normal diode. This is the IV characteristics of a Schottky diode. The cut-in voltage is 0.3 and this is 0.6 for a normal diode. Now let's have a discussion on the rectification or the Schottky contact and the ohmic contact. What's the basic difference between a Schottky contact or the rectification contact and ohmic contact? Let's have a discussion on Schottky or the rectification contact. By default, I am considering the n-type semiconductor. a metal and n-type semiconductor junction. Okay, so this is basically before contact. So your metal energy band diagram looks something like this. This is if and we are considering phi m greater than phi s. Work function of metal is greater than the work function of semiconductor. Okay, this is the Fermi level of metal, and E phi m is basically the work function of metal. It's basically the amount of energy required to transfer the electron from the Fermi level to the vacuum level. Vacuum level is not defined. And you can see this is basically for the n-type semiconductor. This is for the n-type semiconductor. You can see this is the conduction band. This is the valence band. This is basically your valence band. This is EV. This is EC. This is E xi. Xi is basically affinity of an electron. Affinity is defined as the amount of energy required to transfer the electron from the conduction band minima to the vacuum level. Okay, electron from the, you can say the transfer of electron from conduction band minima to vacuum. Okay, this is EFN and this is E phi s. Phi s is defined as the work function of an n-type semiconductor. Okay, is the amount of energy required to transfer the electrons from the Fermi level to the vacuum level. Okay, this is scenario before contact, before the contact has been made between the metal and the semiconductor. Now this is basically the scenario of after contact scenario, and when no biasing is applied across the combination, when the combination is under equilibrium and phi m is greater than phi s is still considered. Okay, so we know that after combining the metal and semiconductor, the Fermi levels need to be at the Fermi energy levels need to be at the same level. So this energy band diagram will basically move downwards up to the point when your n-type semiconductor Fermi level comes at the same level to that of the metal Fermi energy level. So you can see it will move downward until your EFN becomes equal to EFM, and the drop is referred to as the built-in potential or the built-in energy. The conduction band drops down by EV0. EV0 is referred to as the built-in potential. Okay, or you can say the difference between the Fermi levels of metal and n-type semiconductor is referred to as the built-in potential. So the energy band diagram of an n-type semiconductor falls down or moves downward by EV0. Okay, so you can see that after contact, when the combination is in equilibrium, has attained equilibrium and no biasing is applied across it, the energy band diagram will look something like this. Okay, this is EV0. It basically drops down by EV0. So this is the energy level EV0. This is known as uphill. Okay, this will basically pose problem for the electrons from the semiconductor to move from semiconductor to metal. Okay, this is unbiased case when it's in equilibrium. Now consider the case when reverse biasing is applied across the combination, and just to remind you that biasing is always determined by the potential applied to a semiconductor only. So in this case, the positive potential is applied to the n-type semiconductor. So since positive potential is applied to n-type semiconductor, the combination is in reverse biasing mode. The combination is being operated in reverse biasing mode. So when we apply the positive potential, it will cause more problem to the electrons from the semiconductor to transfer to the metal. Okay, because the uphill size has increased. The application of the reverse biasing across the combination results into the increase in the barrier height or the increase in the uphill height. Okay, or increase in the built-in potential or increase in the built-in electric field intensity, which is directed from n-type semiconductor to metal. So you can see that this further drops down by VR. The energy band diagram of the n-type semiconductor further drops down by reverse bias voltage. Okay, and phi b, this is basically the work function of the metal here now. Okay, so you can see that now that EFN and EFM are not at the same level. Or when we apply the forward biasing across the combination, the energy band diagram of the metal moves upward by FF, VF. VF is the forward, VF is basically the forward bias voltage. Forward bias voltage. So this will move in the upward, this will move upward, this will move in the upward direction, making it easy for the, making it relatively easy for the electrons to transfer from the semiconductor to the metal, constituting a forward current. Okay. So energy required to move the electron from Fermi level to vacuum level is defined as a work function. We define V naught as phi m minus phi s is defined as the difference between the work functions of metal and semiconductor. Phi b is defined as phi m minus xi. Okay. Moments after the contact, electrons will stop flowing from the semiconductor to metal due to the built-in electric field. Electrons will also stop flow from metal to semiconductor due to the presence of phi b, which is phi m minus xi, as electrons need to carry phi b potential to flow from metal to semiconductor. Okay, on application of external voltage, so let's just have a practical look at the functioning of the Schottky diode. We apply a potential, external potential Va across this semiconductor, and Va is basically the sinusoidal pulse. When Va is positive, which means that when Va is positive, let me denote it with the red color, because I am denoting the forward biasing as with red color. So when Va is positive, when this is the case, so this will be in forward bias because n-type semiconductor has a negative potential, so barrier height will reduce. So forward biasing, the electrons will be easily able to cross the barrier and move in the metal. Okay, electrons will easily cross the energy barrier, potential barrier, and will basically easily move from n-type semiconductor to metal, constituting a forward current. Hence the output will look something like this. This is when forward biased. Okay, when low supply reverse bias voltage is applied across the junction, across the combination, when low amplitude or when a low voltage, low reverse bias voltage is applied across the junction, what happens? This is the case. Then in this case, the energy barrier height will basically increase, making it very, very difficult or tedious for the electrons to transfer from semiconductor to metal. Hence, there will not be any current flowing in the circuit. So in this case, you can see that current is negligible. Okay, so the output will be zero. It's basically nearly equal to zero output. Okay, so when forward bias, electrons easily flow from semiconductor to metal due to the decrease in the uphill. When reverse bias, electrons in semiconductor find very difficult to flow from semiconductor to metal due to the increase in uphill. Okay, now you must be thinking that since we have applied the reverse bias voltage across the combination, why don't the electrons jump from metal to semiconductor, because they can easily flow from metal to semiconductor? You must be thinking about that, but that's not the case. For that, electrons must possess minimum energy of phi b. Electrons must possess the minimum energy of phi b to cross the energy barrier in order to flow from metal to semiconductor. As you can see that when we apply the reverse bias voltage, of course the electrons will not be able to basically flow from metal to semiconductor, from semiconductor to metal, because of the increased barrier height. But you must be thinking that electrons can easily flow from metal to semiconductor, because that's basically a downhill for the electrons present in the metal. But that's not the case. You have to apply minimum, because you need to apply the minimum voltage, minimum reverse biasing voltage, such that the electrons occupy the energy occupy a minimum energy of phi b, so that they can easily transfer from metal Fermi level to the vacuum level and easily transfer to the semiconductor. Okay, so for that we need to apply a higher order reverse bias voltage across the combination. So on application of a high reverse bias voltage, what happens? Electrons in the metals gain enough energy, which is greater than phi b, which is greater than or equal to phi b, so that they easily cross the work function of the metal and enter into the vacuum zone. And because of the downhill electrons flowing from metal to semiconductor, they flow seamlessly, continuously constituting a reverse current, which we see and we see the output. So the electrons can basically jump from metal to semiconductor. Okay, so you can see we have applied a higher order reverse bias voltage across the combination, which results into very small output voltage. Okay, it's a weak output. This occurs only when energy of electron is greater than phi b. Just keep that thing in mind. If energy is less than phi b, electrons will not be able to traverse from metal to semiconductor, constituting zero current and resulting in zero output voltage. Okay, so because of above characteristics, Schottky diode junction is acting as a rectification junction, as it rectifies the output. So you can see that it's basically rectifying the output. This is basically the input, this is the output, it's acting as a half wave rectifier. Okay, what is ohmic contact? Ohmic contact is formed when phi m is less than phi s. This is with reference to n-type semiconductor used in the metal semiconductor junction diode. Okay, for any biasing applied, that is reverse bias or forward bias, we get the current at the output. So no other operations takes place. Okay, you make a note here that for a metal semiconductor junction with a p-type semiconductor, if phi m is less than phi s, it's a Schottky or rectification contact, and when phi m is greater than phi s, it's an ohmic contact. And for metal semiconductor junction with n-type semiconductor, when phi m is less than phi s, it's an ohmic contact, and when phi m is greater than phi s, it's a Schottky or rectification contact. Okay folks, I'm stopping this lecture here. Hopefully the concepts are clearer to you. And if you have any doubt, and if you find yourself in the dubious situation, please write down your comments in the comment section below. We will get back to you with the solutions. Thank you very much.